Ladies and gentlemen, the broadcast you are about to hear is the actual broadcast that I made on April the 19th, 1995. Deja vu.
You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Today is the second anniversary of the Waco Massacre. And I don't want anyone out there to forget it, ever. 1,000 years from now, I want patriots somewhere, and I mean patriots to principles and ideals of liberty and freedom, to remember the Waco Massacre. Unfortunately, it appears that someone is using this anniversary to promote an agenda, and we will be discussing that. But for right now, there's a vote coming up on the Conference of States in Minnesota. So this is important. The Council of States resolution has passed in the Minnesota House. We must stop it in the Senate. Hearings are scheduled for tomorrow, Thursday the 20th, at 8 a.m. in room 15 at the Capitol. Now, whether or not you intend to testify, please show up to express your opposition. If you don't think you have time, you can't take a day off work, then think again, folks. What price are you willing to pay for freedom? Please make your calls and or fax the message to each senator. Tell them that you oppose the Conference of States and that you would consider it their patriotic duty to vote against it. These are their numbers. All numbers begin with 612-296. Again, all of these numbers begin with 612-296. Senator Berg, 5094. Once again, it's 612-296. All of them begin with those numbers. Senator Berg is 5094. Senator Berglund, 4261. That's 4261. Senator Bertman. Senator Bertman, 2084. That's 2084. Shmielewski, that's Senator Shmielewski, 4182. And don't worry if you can't pronounce the name. Call anyone. 4182. Senator Flynn, 4274. That's 4274. Douglas Johnson, 8881. That's 8881. Senator Lessard, 4136. That's 4136. Senator Marty, 5645. That's 5645. Senator Merriam, 4154. That's 4154. Senator Metzen, 4370. 4370. Senator Moe, 2577. Senator Moe, 2577. Senator Novak, 4334. That's 4334. Senator Piper, 9248. 9248. Senator Pogemiller, 7809. That's 7809. Senator Reichgott, 2889. That's 2889. Senator Salon, 4188. That's 4188. Senator Speer, 4191. That's 4191. Senator Stump, 8660. That's 8660. Senator Vickerman, 5650. That's 5650. The fax number for all of these people, all you have to do is put down their name and send the fax to this number, is 612-296-6511. That's 612-296-6511. Remember, this is for the state of Minnesota. Ladies and gentlemen, Minnesota is going to vote on the Conference of States resolution. It's passed through the House. Hearings are scheduled for tomorrow morning, Thursday the 20th, at 8 a.m. in room 15 at the Capitol. Be there. Oppose it. Whether you're going to be there or not, call all of these senators and fax and oppose this. And make sure, ladies and gentlemen, that you do this. It is important. And now, this morning, just after most of the workers had entered the federal office building in Oklahoma City and prepared for their daily routine, an explosion occurred. Was prepared for this, ladies and gentlemen, least of all those inside the building, who found themselves suddenly falling, tumbling through the air. Many of them were buried beneath tons of debris. As usual, the intelligence service has all of the facts that are available at this time, and you will find these facts have not been reported in their entirety anywhere else in the world, including the major media in the United States, including even the media in Oklahoma City. As usual, we have our people on scene with press passes in hand, and they have given us a preliminary report, which I will now relay to you. It is important that you listen carefully, ladies and gentlemen, because rumors, as always, abound. And we have heard every rumor and every possible solution to this. What you are going to get now are the facts. Then we will discuss some of the reports, erroneous and otherwise. There is an agenda here. And if you will remember, I told you that this would happen. I said it on this broadcast that the incidents of terrorism within the United States will escalate to the point undreamed of by the American people. What is the agenda? Well, you're going to find out. Our station chief was in Oklahoma City all day. Most of the facts that are available have been scantily reported on the local news in Oklahoma City only. The national news reports, especially on ABC, are completely off base and out of line. As you might expect, the body count keeps going up, but as far as actual on-the-scenes reporting goes, at 4:30 p.m. this afternoon, Oklahoma time, only 22 confirmed dead, 17 of them children from the daycare center. Washington was reporting 81 dead, but no one on the scene can confirm any numbers yet that even approach that number. The number confirmed at 4:30 p.m. was 22 dead, 17 of them children. The Washington, D.C. figure may have more to do with government workers who cannot be reached by phone. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, only 30% of the federal building has been searched because of the danger of the rest of the building collapsing. And search and rescue has been hampered by some intermittent but heavy rain. Temperatures have been falling rapidly in the Oklahoma City area. There are certainly enough people still missing to easily exceed the Washington death estimate, but at this time their numbers cannot be considered as fact. There are parts of the building which seem held together only by the grace of God. You can look right through the building in several places. As our station chief drove through the Oklahoma City area, she saw glass damage from the explosive concussion as far away as Northwest 23rd Street, which is approximately 2 miles north of the federal building, and as far west as Pennsylvania Avenue, which is about 3 miles west. Her brother-in-law heard the explosion in his office in Edmond, about 15 miles north of Oklahoma City. Her sister-in-law is at this hour still on duty at Children's Hospital, where she works as a nurse. She has been on duty since 7 a.m. this morning and expects to have to continue working throughout the night as more of the injured are brought in all the time. Immediately after the explosion, ladies and gentlemen, the shopping mall at Northwest 50th and Penn was evacuated because it houses a smaller office of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. No mention was made of sealing off any areas in Norman, which is 17 miles south of Oklahoma City. In particular, the office of the FBI, which is located about 4 blocks from the front door of one of our operatives. Tinker Air Force Base was put on emergency alert, and for several hours, no one was admitted on or off the base. Later in the day, base personnel were allowed onto the base, but everyone entering was subjected to a total identification check, and some were searched. The entire Oklahoma Capitol complex was evacuated about 2 hours after the explosion so that the building could be swept for explosives. Army personnel and drug-sniffing dogs were brought in from Fort Sill to search out anything that could be found in the Capitol complex and upon the bomb scene. There have been no further local reports about that investigation since about 4 p.m. Mayor Ron Norick has stated that there were approximately 590 federal employees in the building on the job when the bomb exploded. And there may have been an additional 200 to 400 citizens conducting business in the building at that time. So there could have been, ladies and gentlemen, somewhere around 1,000 people in that building. The total figure at this moment is unknown. The total number of persons reported admitted to area hospitals because of this incident at approximately 4:30 p.m. this afternoon, Oklahoma City time, were just under 300. Many persons are believed still buried in the rubble, and few living that have been rescued were suffering from crush injuries, lacerations from flying glass, and other injuries associated with explosions. One woman buried in the parking garage had to have her leg amputated before she could be removed. According to Dr. Cornelison, who made the report, she would not have lived had the amputation not been performed. There have been many such spur-of-the-moment street corner surgeries performed while rescue vehicles made their way to the scene to remove the injured and the dead. Reports have been heard on radio of 200 adult-sized body bags being brought to the scene in anticipation of the number of bodies yet to be recovered from the building. And unless a tent has been recently erected on the side of the street, the bodies are still being held in a semi-truck, which is serving as a temporary morgue. Huge floodlights have been brought in by an oil field equipment company, and large heaters are also being provided to the scene as rescue work continues into the cold of the night. Police and firefighters on the scanner report that they have heard no other moans or cries for help from any of the already searched area for the last 2 hours. No one can begin to estimate what the situation may be in the remaining 60% of the building. Only a few hours ago, firefighters began working on the second story of the building, searching for anyone or anything. There are 9 stories total, which must be sifted carefully. And the work, ladies and gentlemen, is painstakingly slow because of the dangerous condition of the remaining structure. A lot of heroics have manifested on the part of the rescue workers. A special investigative team from Phoenix has arrived to assist in the search for survivors, and it is reported that they have special sound equipment which can detect the tiny sounds of breathing beneath rubble and debris. They are at work now. All roads leading into the main downtown area have been closed off and are being guarded by police and National Guard troops. FEMA is conducting a practice exercise. They have seized the moment, and the Federal Communications Commission is going through their routine of clearing the frequencies for the use of the Federal Emergency Management Agency. Our station chief drove south on Walker from Northwest 23rd Street trying to get closer, but was turned aside by guarded roadblocks. She tried entering the area from several different possible back roads routes, but there were simply too many police, National Guard, Highway Patrol, and sheriff's deputies to get anywhere near the scene, despite the fact that she possesses a valid press pass and credentials representing the Kaji News Service and Veritas newspaper. Every little alleyway and gravel half road that she tried to access was fully guarded and sealed. The perimeter is solid. And I can assure you, if there was a way to get on the scene, our people would have done it. And in fact, one has, but until that person comes out again, we cannot get a report. For there is no communications out of the area unless you have access to the emergency communications equipment of the officials on the scene. Representatives from Oklahoma Natural Gas were allowed through the roadblocks to get to their damaged building because they are in the process of cutting off all gas lines leading into the downtown area until the total damage can be assessed. All customer calls have been routed to the Tulsa office. The only other people being allowed through the roadblocks are medical personnel who can flash medical cards. No one else is being allowed into the area, regardless of the reason. No members of the local press who were not on the scene within the first hour have been allowed in since the rumor spread of a second and then a third possible bomb. These rumors are not true. And at that time, everyone in the downtown area who did not have a medical, fire, or police function was moved back away from the federal building area, a distance of 5 blocks. There was a media center for the press set up at 7th and Harvey, which is within walking distance of the location of the press conference, which was held earlier today. Because of the general chaos, ladies and gentlemen, no information of any real substance is coming out of this area. Earlier reports were made of 3 possible suspects in a blue pickup truck with tinted windows, 2 of Middle Eastern appearance between the age of 25 and 35, and a 3rd male, no description given, who supposedly was driving this pickup truck. Nothing was said about why they were suspects. But I question this, and so do our agents on the scene, for there is a large population of Middle Eastern Muslims in Oklahoma City, Edmond and Norman, and the University of Oklahoma has several large Islamic student community groups. Unless the 3 men actually did something suspicious, there should have been nothing out of the ordinary about their presence. Many such individuals live and work in this area, especially in that part of downtown Oklahoma City, which houses so many offices for Middle Eastern businesses. These are some of the rumors and erroneous reports and guesses and speculations that have been broadcast around the world today. Now remember, these are rumors, speculations. A local television station in Oklahoma City received a call from an unidentified male reportedly speaking with a foreign accent who stated that the Nation of Islam claimed responsibility for the bombing. On another broadcast, Dave McCurdy, former Democratic congressman, promptly came on television and repeated the same unsubstantiated rumor. An hour later, an alleged official from the Nation of Islam telephoned KTOK Radio from Chicago to deny any responsibility for the bombing. On one station, an explosives expert being interviewed stated that all neo-Nazi groups, right-wing extremist political organizations, and fundamentalist religious groups would naturally be suspect because of their supposed hatred of the government. And early on, a political science professor from OCU suggested that the bombing might be the result of disgruntled tax protesters. A second explosives expert, ladies and gentlemen, was interviewed, who stated that the type of bomb that might have been used, since no one knows at this time, was not of the sort that a small local group could assemble, and that it was more likely that the bombing was the work of an organization with much funding and international ties. He suggested that investigators check to see what major drug trials might be going on at this time, and noted that there were similarities between the federal building bombing here and that of the World Trade Center 2 years ago. He also remarked about the fact that the courthouse building is located right behind the federal building, but nothing further was said about that. And I have to say, ladies and gentlemen, that if this second explosives expert is right, he has pinned the Central Intelligence Agency. Another report from the scene stated that firefighters going through the rubble of the federal building discovered other explosive devices and plastic, which had been allegedly kept in the offices of the ATF located in the federal building. That's the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. That particular report, unlike all of the others heard today, was never reported again. We've also not heard it mentioned further on the scanner. It was either another untrue rumor, or if it was true, was quickly squashed. A later radio report made mention of a rocket launcher being found in the debris, which was supposed to have also been in the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms office. That report also has never been repeated, substantiated, or denied. The Hour of the Time is brought to you, ladies and gentlemen, by Swiss America Trading. We suggest that if you want protection of your assets against what is sure to come, and this is just a taste, those of you who have been listening to this broadcast for a long period of time, you know, many of you have already prepared. As prediction after prediction comes true right on schedule, not because I'm psychic, not because God talks to me, not because I look into a crystal ball, not because I'm in contact with extraterrestrial beings or channel the ascended masters, but because I've studied for the last 25 years. It is obvious to anyone who wants to look what is happening, who is bringing it about, and where it is headed. The incidents of terrorism will escalate. The power of the police state will escalate exponentially. Freedoms, liberty will disappear. All nations and all people will be disarmed. There are Russian agents in this country now supervising the disarmament of the United States of America, and we have people in Russia supervising, supposedly, their disarmament also. The Open Skies Treaty allows the overflight of Russian or any other nation who is signatory to the treaty with their aircraft, using the most sophisticated of intelligence gathering equipment, the best optics that you can imagine, to identify, pinpoint, and supervise the reduction of armed forces and the disarming of the military and the people of all nations. As this happens, we will continue to escalate into a state of anarchy and chaos. Ordo ab chao. Out of chaos. For protection and control. And they will get it. They will get it in spades, and they will regret it forever. A one-world totalitarian socialist government is coming. As this state of chaos takes form, food will say this again so that there is no misunderstanding. As this state of chaos develops, as local anarchy takes form, food will disappear from the supermarket shelves. The economy will collapse. Those who have not prepared are going to find themselves in a ditch. Now, these are harsh warnings, but they are real, true warnings, and they come from my heart, from a position of knowledge. This is not conjecture. This is what is planned for America. Patriots who are determined not to give up their liberty will fight. Those who will not take sides either with the New World Order or with patriots in this country will be the flotsam and jetsam upon the tides of war and will be at the mercy of the victor. One gold or silver coin could save your life. No one during that period of time will accept paper money under any circumstances. If you do not have something useful or real money to trade on a black market, you will be helpless. You will be hungry, and you will be without shelter. I suggest you call 1-800-289.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to the actual broadcast that I aired on April the 19th, 1995. Deja vu. In this broadcast, I made some startling predictions which most of the people listening ignored. Those predictions are now coming home.
Capacity to understand it. You heard it here a long time ago. And I hate the fact that they are coming true. But I have studied for so many years that I know how this will proceed and how it will come about. The incidents of terrorism in the United States will escalate beyond your capacity to understand it. And I hate the fact that they are coming true. But I have studied for so many years that I know how this will proceed and how it will come about.
the incidents of terrorism in the United States will escalate beyond your capacity to understand it. And you will be without shelter. I suggest you call 1-800-289-26. And I suggest you watch my predictions and I hate the fact that they are coming true. But I have studied for so many years that I know how this will proceed and how it will come about. The incidents of terrorism in the United States will escalate beyond your capacity to understand it. You heard it here a long time ago. If you read my book, you read it in my book. If you attended my lectures, you heard me tell you in my lectures, every prediction I have ever made but one has come true. Everything that I wrote about in my book, that at the time nothing had materialized and people called me crazy, have now come to pass. The only time I have been wrong on predicting a future event was when I said that Manuel Noriega would not be found guilty in a court of law or serve any time in prison because under the rule of international sovereignty of nations, without a declaration of war, we had no authority to go down there and take the head of another sovereign nation and bring him here and try him in a court. For under international law, they have immunity. So do all diplomats. You're going to see that disappear also. The sovereignty of nations is no more, including the sovereignty of the United States of America. The military forces, the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines are functioning as the police force of the United Nations under Publication 7277 of the State Department's plan for the unification of the armed forces of what used to be called the Soviet Union under the United Nations to function as the only armed force left in the world to maintain peace and order and to ensure the disarmament of all nations and all peoples. This is not conjecture, it's documented in the law. It is a fact. And you have had your head buried in the sand for too long. And what happened today in Oklahoma City was a part of the agenda to bring about the New World Order. You watch as the stories continue to unfold. It is no accident that this occurred on the second anniversary of the Waco massacre, as you shall soon see, without any input from me. It will become plain. Just keep your eye on the lips of Janet Reno.
Deja vu.
At 3 p.m. Oklahoma City time, the statement was made on radio that the only persons who might plant a bomb beside a daycare center, which was located in the second floor of the federal building, would be people who had lost children themselves because of the government's actions and thus we should all suspect survivors of the Branch Davidians. This was immediately poo-pooed by the KTOK news anchor, who may have more sense than anyone previously thought. But this will surface again, I assure you. A later report tied Bob Ricks into the situation because of his involvement in the Waco massacre. His office is in Oklahoma City. When questioned at the 5 p.m. press conference about the possibility of a link between the Branch Davidians and today's bombing, Ricks said merely that nothing is being ruled out and nobody knows anything yet. Very noncommittal as he shifted uncomfortably from side to side. Intelligence service members have recorded some very interesting conversations from the scanner. One such conversation was being held with a nurse on the scene who was speaking on a cordless phone. She was telling a friend of her experience on the bomb scene and mentioned that as she assisted a policeman with the removal of one of the victims from the rubble, he said, quote, "We're going to go to war over this," end quote. The majority of rescue workers are completely stressed out at this time. Tempers are short, and all patience has been exhausted. They are liable to say anything. You can hear it in every voice on the scanner. Most emergency personnel who have been interviewed on radio and television seem completely shocked, and it is evident that they were totally unprepared for the sheer scope of the carnage and devastation. The First Christian Church near the scene has been turned into a counseling center for people on the scene who are too upset to function, as well as for family members of the injured and the dead. The church has staffed the building with psychologists, psychiatrists, and anyone with any counseling training to deal with the people who are in extreme emotional shock. And ladies and gentlemen, I have to tell you, there are so many such people. A call went out over the radio this afternoon asking for more trained counselors and medical personnel to come and help. The post office building has been turned into a temporary hospital. Several triage centers have also been established in several nearby streets. Don't expect to get any mail from Oklahoma City on time. Many local restaurateurs, in coordination with the Feed the Children organization, are providing food for the emergency personnel at the scene, and indeed for anyone who comes along who needs it.
Deja vu.
The Red Cross has been taking blood donations all day long and have put out statewide calls for donors of type O blood. The Blood Institute on North Lincoln Boulevard is still taking donors at this time, and the wait after arrival is now about an hour.
Deja vu.
People are parked wherever they can on the grass, the sidewalks, along the streets, where traffic normally flows, desperately searching for friends and loved ones.
Deja vu.
Our station chief has been monitoring the search and rescue situation all day in her car, and as soon as her husband got home, he began audio taping off the scanner while simultaneously videotaping from the television set. And around 5:30 p.m., our Washington people began meeting with the governor in the governor's mansion, supposedly to get coordinated with the federal investigators sent in by Waco, Reno. And the governor has announced that the entire investigation is now in the hands of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Should we cheer? The last time anyone's lives were in the hands of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, They were burnt crisp.
Deja vu.
And the ATF wore T-shirts hailing their Texas barbecue. So forgive me if I'm not thrilled that the investigation is now in the hands of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. The most accurate information comes off the scanner, and we are taping constantly all around the area. There is no transmission being made that escapes our agents. The FBI and the BATF have now set up an operational headquarters at 11 Northeast 6th Street. At 7 p.m. Oklahoma time, a call over the scanner reported packages discovered at the Medallion Hotel, and a request was made for a bomb dog to be taken to the hotel, but a search of the phone directory shows that there is no such hotel listed in the Oklahoma City phone book. If anything transpires on that, we will, of course, let you know. Things are constantly continuing to happen. There's a tremendous amount of danger connected to that building, and no one really knows what is holding the rest of it up. When they tell you that half of the building was blown away, that is not quite the truth. Half the building was indeed blown away, ladies and gentlemen. But the only thing that remains is a shell of the other half, for the entire inside of the building was gutted. We have people on scene, and we have people in every aspect of public service reporting to us constantly. As you have heard tonight, this is the only complete and factual report that has occurred through any media all day long. Deja vu. And that is due to the people who have dedicated their resources and their lives and have taken an oath as officers and men and women of the intelligence service of the Second Continental Army of the Republic. Thank them.
Deja vu.
What happened in Oklahoma City only too conveniently overshadows Waco 2 years ago. Memorize that sound, ladies and gentlemen. You will hear it more and more in America. Not because I want it, and believe me, I have nothing whatsoever to do with it. It is a part of the agenda of the emerging one world totalitarian socialist state. It is furthering the agenda of the disarmament of the American people and indeed the peoples and the nations of the world. It is a deceit. It is a lie. It is a manipulation. Deja vu. Hezbollah has no truck with April the 19th. No patriot in this country would ever attack our government without being attacked by this government first. That I can assure you. No fundamentalist religious organization has any reason to bomb any building in Oklahoma City. We all know in our hearts why this was done and whose agenda it furthers. We must never, ever, in our lives, or in our children's lives, or in our grandchildren's lives, or their children and grandchildren's lives, forget what happened in Waco, Texas on April the 19th, 1993. I urge you to phone this number and tell them that their scam doesn't work. We remember Waco, and we will hold them accountable. And eventually, the real perpetrators of this crime that occurred in Oklahoma City will be found, and we will also hold them accountable. The number is 1-800-546.
Ladies and gentlemen, that number was good in 1995. I cannot guarantee that it is good now, but it does no harm to try.
546. 3-2-2-4. It is the number of the Justice Department. 1-800-546-3224. 1-800-546-3224. 1-800-546-3224. We remember Waco. We will hold the perpetrators responsible, ultimately, under the law. The fax number is 202-616-9898. 202-616-9898. 202-616-9898. Insist upon a complete investigation of the Waco massacre. Insist upon a thorough and complete investigation of the bombing of the federal building in Oklahoma City, and insist upon an independent criminal investigation that does not involve the Federal Bureau of Investigation or the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms.
And you might want to insist that the same independent investigation be conducted into the recent terrorist attacks upon the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center buildings and the Pentagon. Deja vu.
The numbers are 1-800-546-3224. 1-800-546-3224. 202-616-9898.
ladies and gentlemen, tonight has been a rerun of the actual broadcast that I aired on April the 19th, 1995. Ladies and gentlemen, you heard the predictions that I made during that broadcast. You heard it for yourself. There was no mysterious anything about any of it. Nothing whatsoever. And most of you discounted my warnings. I made predictions that have come true. And I'm going to make some more predictions. Ladies and gentlemen, the incidents of terrorism in the United States will continue to escalate beyond your ability to understand them. I am speaking to you live right now. The incidents of terror, the attacks upon this nation, will continue to escalate beyond your ability to comprehend or understand them. The goal will be to cower, to take away the will of the American people, to cause them to give up all of their freedoms, all of their rights, to cause them to actually allow the government to suspend the Constitution, even though in this country, even in the most serious national emergency, the Constitution does not allow for such an occurrence. What is happening is treason. And while George Bush may pan for the cameras and insist that in the pursuit of the war on terrorism, he will not damage the freedom of the American people or a traditional way of life, he is a bold-faced liar. He and Congress both, through executive orders and legislation, are destroying what little is left of the rights and the freedoms of the American people protected by the Constitution for the United States of America. And make no mistake about it, this nation is under martial law as I speak right now and has been under martial law since September the 11th, 2001. Ladies and gentlemen, you have a choice and what you're going to do with your life, and what kind of life you're going to pass down to your children, your grandchildren, and your great-grandchildren. Are they going to live in freedom? Or because of your cowardice, your fear, your stupidity, will they live as slaves in a future world totalitarian socialist government? I'd like to know exactly what's going to happen in that regard. Unfortunately, I can't speak to all of you, but I do know one thing. The majority of the human race is nothing but a bunch of abject cowards, and that's been proven throughout the history of the world. Good night. God bless each and every single one of you. Good night, Annie Kuhn Allison. I love you. Get off your ass. Get out of your lethargy. Find your guts. Find your balls. And do something. Don't accept the tyranny that's coming as a result of the treason and the attacks that have occurred against this nation and against its people.